Excuse me, can you hear me? And can you see the screen? So there was a problem. Sorry, there was a problem with the communication with the stop, and I went offline for some time. Okay, can you excuse me? I lost track of when I went offline. Can you tell me what I was talking about? When I went offline. So let me say that probably when I was talking about the control center. The control center, okay, on the control station and control center. The control center is located in general very far away from the stations. And the reason is that today we have very fast communication links with the stations, and therefore the control center can reside in places which are much more convenient. For example, for the European Space Station, the control center is located in Darmstadt, Germany. In the US, the human flight space missions control center is located in Houston, Texas. For planetary missions, or at least most of them, the location is in Pasadena, California. So all these control centers are connected to all the stations employed in the tracking of a spacecraft or of a mission. So, as I said, we will say something about all these topics. Let me, however, introduce first the different types of radio links that one can establish with a satellite. Well, we distinguish three configurations. One-way configuration, which is configuration where the ground antenna acts as a receiver only antenna, a receiving only antenna, or listen only antenna. So the spacecraft transmits, but there is no uplink. There is only downlink from the spacecraft down to Earth. This station in general is not a station enabled to transmit commands. So it receives data, it receives telemetry. And this configuration is called one-way. Then we have when the ground antenna simultaneously transmits and receives the spacecraft signal, so is able to send telecommands and receive telemetry, we have a two-way configuration. This configuration can have two different flavors. One is the coherent configuration, so we speak of a coherent link. Sorry, I have to get the pen again. So we have a coherent link, but It's possible also to have a situation where the link is non-coherent. So, if the uplink signal and the downlink signal are phase coherent, so on board the spacecraft there is a device which essentially receives the uplink signal and transmits it back to ground coherently, and with coherence we intend a phase preserving system, a system which preserves the phase of the received microwave signal. Then we have a coherent link. But when we are in a configuration like this, in which there is no relation between the uplink and the downlink, here we have a box, for example, a transponder, and there is no relation between the two, we speak of two-way non-coherent link. Finally, we have a three-way configuration. A three-way configuration is attained when we have one station transmitting and another different station receiving. This is the three-way radio link. There are many ways, many reasons why to establish a three-way radio link. One is, for example, the command station generally is only one or only few command station, and you send commands only from a single station. You don't want to send multiple commands from multiple stations. So there can be only one uplink. But the signal radiated from the spacecraft to ground is available to everybody. Even myself, I could put an antenna on my roof and receive the signal from the satellite. This is what I do with my TV system, for example. Satellite TV system used this way. Of course, I'm not a ground station in the proper sense, but I receive the signal from the spacecraft, from the satellite. And there is the possibility to distribute data directly from space to many users on land. And this is a situation where a three-way radio link is useful. But there are also other applications of three-way radio links. For example, in planetary exploration, one almost necessarily goes through a three-way radio link, at least for part of the time. Suppose, for example, that we have a mission to Saturn, where the round-trip lifetime can exceed 2 hours. So we typically transmit from one antenna. When the spacecraft, for example, is low on the horizon, we transmit from one antenna at a given longitude and receive the signal from an antenna which may be located thousands of kilometers away. And for example, the Deep Space Network. If here we have the Earth and we have a spacecraft far away, I locate it here. Okay. There are antennas, the antennas of the Deep Space Network are located more or less at a separation of 120 degrees, roughly speaking. This ensures that at least one station is in visibility of the spacecraft. So, for example, you may be in a situation where This antenna, you see, the spacecraft is close to the horizon, can still transmit to the spacecraft, but the downlink can be established with this one. And this is a consequence of the long light time to the spacecraft. Imagine a mission like Voyager 2, whose round trip light time now is essentially close, I think, to 24 hours. So the signal is sent by this station to the spacecraft. The spacecraft transmits it back, and in the meanwhile, however, the Earth is rotated by almost 360 degrees. So this means that we are still in a two-way configuration, but the Earth has rotated, has done a full turn around while the signal is propagating back and forth to the spacecraft. Okay? This is a form of two special form of two-way, which resembles a three-way. Anyway, the message is that when we are close to handover between one station and another, located very far away, as in the case of the DSN. DSN stands for Deep Space Network. Well, is unavoidable to have a three-way configuration for part of the time, which one station transmits and the other receives. Now, which frequencies do we use in space telecommunications? The frequencies, as I said, are mostly microwave. And I found useful, however, to introduce this figure because it gives you an idea of the limitation of the use of the various frequency bands. So those of you who took the space environment course know already that in the visible window here, the Earth atmosphere is essentially transparent. But if we go in the infrared, the atmosphere starts absorbing radiation, and this is one of the reasons for actually the fundamental reason for the greenhouse effect. So what you see here is the frequency on the x-axis and the opacity. The opacity is a quantity which is precisely defined, but in the context of this course, you can consider it as a degree of the inverse of transparency. An opaque atmosphere, one which absorbs, say, 100% of the radiation, is an atmosphere that kind of radiation, where that kind of radiation cannot go through. So, if we move to the microwave region, and the microwave region goes essentially from, let us say, 1 GHz up to 300 and even more, we see that the Atmosphere is opaque, roughly to 200 gigahertz, and start becoming transparent, actually is transparent, around from 3 to 8 gigahertz, even below 1, let us say 1 gigahertz to 8 gigahertz. And become, however, more and more opaque when we increase in frequency, unfortunately, I say, and I will say why. You see this dip? This dip is exploited by people doing space telecommunications. Because it corresponds to the so-called Ka band region, which is, let us say, around 34 gigahertz. I should say 32, 34 gigahertz. And is exploited. There are strong pushes for the reason that we will see to go toward higher frequencies. Higher frequencies have the benefit of enabling, in principle, higher data rates because the directivity of the antenna is increased with the frequency. However, we have this limitation due to the Earth atmosphere, and there is nothing we can do with it. So far, most of the communications occurred in this band, this one here. But there is a strong push to go to higher frequencies and make the lower frequencies available to ground telecommunications. Also, at lower frequencies, the amount of interferences that we get is really large. And if you think cellular phones today use gigahertz frequencies, while times ago it was not possible, the electronics has improved, and so there is a strong push to go to higher frequencies also for this reason. However, what is the cause for this absorption? Why the atmosphere starts to increase its opacity as we go from 8 to 10 gigahertz above? Well, essentially is water. The water molecules have rotational levels in that bandwidth, a very rich spectrum of rotational levels that absorb energy very easily. And especially liquid water, when water is in liquid state, it becomes a powerful absorber. This is one of the reasons why ground stations for deep space telecommunications, especially or space telecommunication in general, have to be located in dry sites, in sites where it doesn't rain too much, in sites where the water vapor content in the atmosphere is low. And this is attained, unfortunately, in places which are not easy to reach. Well, deserts, of course, or high elevations. And if you combine deserts with high elevations, for example, go to the Atacama Desert in the Argentinian Chilean Andes at 5,000 meter elevation, you would get an outstanding site for a ground antenna. Unfortunately, the logistical problems are so large that these sites are not exploited for space telecommunications. Unfortunately, because I tried to convince the European Space Station to build its third antenna sites over there in the Atacama Desert, and they decided to put it essentially the same latitude, but east of the Andes in Argentina at a much lower elevation, 1500 meters, which is not a bad site, but would have been a lot better to stay at higher elevation. We would have had an outstanding Ka-band ground antenna. Anyway, in this rectangle, partly transparent rectangle, you see the region where the region of the spectrum were used by space telecommunications. So, telecommanding is a function where from a ground control center we can control the state and configure the state of a satellite. We can load instructions for maneuvers, for example. We can control the power usage. We can configure the instruments in different modes. We can turn off or on instruments. So commands are vital to let a space system do what we want. And which frequencies are used in establishing an uplink, which is where telecommands essentially travel on? Well, we use these three frequency bands. I mentioned them already. S band, which is less and less used because of the pressure from ground systems, so from general usage and general users, cellular phones, for example. So there is a big push from human activities on the Earth to appropriate of this frequency band, which, as I said before, is very rich of interferences. So this goes from, say, 2 gigahertz to 2.1 gigahertz for the uplink. Much more used today is the X-band system and X-band frequencies from 7.1 to 7.2 gigahertz. The bandwidth is relatively narrow. As you can see, it's not large. It's essentially 90 megahertz only. So this is certainly a limitation. While we have a much bigger freedom at Ka-band. Ka-band here is 32-35 gigahertz. However, if you look back, let us go back to the previous slide. The Ka-band, you see, stays in this dip here. So we exploit this partial transparency for Ka-band. Still, about 50% of the signal on average is absorbed by the atmosphere. So these are the frequency bands for the uplink. To send telecommands, We modulate the carrier. And there are different modulation schemes that can be used. They are not part of this course. I will only say a few things later on. But there are different modulation schemes. In general, let me say that the uplink data rate needs not to be large. So for uplink in general, we don't need large bandwidth and large data rates. Telecommands, after all, at least configuration telecommands are not do not require a large bit rate. Things are different if we want to upload on board large volume of data, for example, movies and so on. But this is done once in a while. So for telemetry, the situation is inverse. Telemetry carries data, scientific data, payload data, let us say, but also housekeeping data. Housekeeping data are all those parameters that tell us about the state of the spacecraft. The state of the spacecraft means we want to know how healthy a spacecraft is, and of course, if there is a problem, these housekeeping data provide the clue to the solution of the problem. For the frequency bands that are used, again, we have S-band here, which is, we can call the old standard. Today, tends to be used essentially for emergency only. And then we have X-band. You see that the frequencies are slightly different from those of the uplink. If you remember, the uplink frequency at S-band was going from 2 to 2.1 GHz. Here we were going from 7 to 7.2 GHz. So the downlink frequencies are of course separated from the uplink ones, and we will see why. Let us finish this chart, and then we will make the break. We have the Ka-band frequency. This is Ka-band, you see, which is mostly used for deep space missions. And for high data rate Earth satellites, today we are using also this band, which is KKA, named KKA. You may wonder why this nomenclature S, X, K, KA, L. Well, the frequency spectrum was essentially explored in depth during the Second World War. And this attribution to the different bands, to the different regions of the spectrum, was done for military reasons. Essentially, the Allied militaries, British and American, didn't want to let the Germans or the Japanese know what they were talking about. So these letters were chosen with the declared purpose to confuse the enemy. So there is no logic into this naming, K, KA, etc., etc. And for the time being, I would stop here. We'll make a break. We will reconvene at 11:17, and in the meanwhile, I will answer questions. So, are the data sent by non-military or commercial satellite encrypted? For example, Sentinel-3. Today we tend to encrypt most data, also commercial data, because if you want to sell an image or sell something, and there are companies that are selling images in spectral images of the Earth, you don't want that somebody can get them for free. This is called piracy, and therefore, for these reasons, even commercial data from commercial satellites are encrypted. The same, of course, for even stronger reasons, holds for military. But encryption is nothing. Encryption is something which doesn't change the structure of the telecom link. Okay? So you can transmit pure noise or transmit encrypted data or clear data. The telecommunication system basically is the same. It's only the computer which tells which bits to transmit to ground. Therefore, the computer which does the encryption or the computer which decrypts the signal, which is doing the job. So again, sorry, I mean non-commercial services. Well, I can tell you that, for example, data from deep space missions, they are not encrypted. It's not easy to send a command to a deep space mission because you need a large antenna. And even the uplink, as far as I know, has never been encrypted. And these are certainly non-commercial satellites. And I frankly don't know whether non-commercial satellites are today, what is the percentage of those satellites which use encrypted communication? Certainly, the problem of cybersecurity is a big one. And in the future, it would be very unfortunate if somebody sends commands on board to a spacecraft to disable it. So, in the future, especially for Earth satellites, I think that is more and more likely that all services, both telecommands and telemetry, will be encrypted. Then there was a question on the opacity. Does the opacity introduce noises larger in the transmitter or received data? No, the opacity has the same effect. The opacity affects the signal-to-noise ratio. We will see. And therefore, the probability of making a mistake, an error, in the deco in decoding a telecommand or a data, a telemetry data. It reduces the signal to noise ratio. So it's democratic with respect to uplink and downlink. So, if there are other questions, please go ahead. I will take a couple of minutes break to get a cup of coffee, but please write your questions on the chat. So I don't see any other questions on the chat. So we will let's wait another couple of minutes. Okay, let's restart. And what are the basic blocks of a satellite communication system? And remember, the satellite communication system is used for multiple purposes. And one of these, the one on which we are mostly interested in, is navigation. So, acquiring navigation observables. So, the building blocks are written here. They are antennas that need to convert to generate a radio frequency to transmit to ground a signal generated on board, an RF signal generated on board. We need amplifiers, which amplify essentially the tiny signal that may be produced by the master clock, up-converted signal from the master clock or the ground antenna, or from a transponder. We need transmitters, we need receivers, and we need a channel model. On board, these three functions, transmitting, receiving, and channel model, let us say, a single unit called transponder, which is really the heart of the onboard telecommunication system. Let us start for the only passive elements that we have mentioned before, the antennas. And there is a fundamental fact. In space, and especially for space exploration, planetary exploration, distances are large. Therefore, we are forced to work with relatively weak signals. And if we want to transmit high data rates, we will see that we need a lot of power. The more power we receive, the larger the data rate can be. All this points to the need of very directive antennas. And the most directive antenna that we know is the parabolic reflector. So in space telecommunications, for routine operations, we use parabolic antennas, and parabolic antennas means taking a parabola and rotate about its axis. So it's a symmetric shape. Remember the definition of a parabola. Sometimes at exams, I'm forced to ask what is the definition of a parabola. Every aerospace engineer must know to define a parabola, and the parabola is the locus of points which have the same distance from a line like this one, called the directus. So this distance must be equal to this distance. Okay? This is the definition of a parabola. And it really it's essential that you come to the exam with this definition in mind, because sometimes really it's disappointing and frustrating to see that when I ask how is a parabola defined, no, somebody is not able to answer, because every aerospace engineer should know this definition, like the definition of an ellipse or the definition of a hyperbole, etc. So, the parabola or the parabolic reflectors have the property, the nice property, that all in the limit of geometric optics, all the rays which are coming parallel to the axis of the parabola, this axis is sometimes also called the optical axis of the antenna. Which in this case is this line. Well, they have the property that all rays coming parallel to the optical axis of the parabola are reflected and concentrated on a point called the focus, which is the focus. And this is very important. And also very important is the fact that all the rays that are reaching the focus, they reach the focus with the same phase. So, some fundamental concepts here. Given the large distance of the spacecraft from the antenna, let us assume that this, for example, is a ground antenna, but the same arguments apply to a transmitting antenna. So this is a receiving antenna, and we have radio waves coming from far away. The equal phase surfaces can be approximated as plane waves. Why? Well, plane waves, because if the system, the spacecraft is very far away, of course, the equal phase surfaces will be a sphere, but at least in a certain region of space. But if you look at the sphere of very large radius over a spatial scale, which is the diameter of the parabola, it will look like as a plane wave. So this is called the plane wave approximation that for space communications is an excellent one. So we know that phase, the phase phi, okay, is defined as kx, k is the wave number, minus omega t plus an arbitrary phase, initial phase, which depends on the reference point that we are considering. So this phase is a function of space, the spatial coordinates x, and we can assume that this is the x-axis, and time t. So if we take a snapshot of phase in space at a given time, so we fix t equal a certain t0, the terms minus omega t0 plus phi 0 is a constant, and we have the phase pattern in space. You see that phase is proportional to distance. And you understand now why all reflected rays, this one, like all reflected rays, reach the focus with the same phase. Because the phase phi, I write it here, is equal to 2 pi over lambda, which is the wave number, times x. So essentially is 2 pi the ratio between the distance, travel distance, and wavelength lambda. So if the distance is the same for all rays at the focal point F, well, this means that the all rays reach the focal point with the same phase, and therefore there will be constructive interference between all rays. And it's very easy to demonstrate on the basis of definition of what a parabola is, that all rays arrive with the same phase. Because if this distance is equal to this distance here, so AF is equal to A prime, and this is a consequence of the definition of a parabola. Okay, so this means that the traveled distance for this ray is, let us call this point W. W a prime is the travel distance. But this other reflected ray, travels from W to B prime, travels the same distance. And if I take another ray which starts from here, okay, is reflected to the focus. By definition of a parabola, travel distance is the same. So the phase with which the reflected rays reach the focus are the same. Okay? So they arrive at the prime focus of the parabola in phase. And when they arrive in phase, we have constructive interference. Okay? Constructive interference. And therefore, if we put there let us say, an element which is able to detect voltages, this element will be able to see a power which is much larger, than the one that if we put that element elsewhere, so outside the prime focus. Why? Because all the power, all the energy transmitted per unit time and received per unit time is focused in a point. So this tells you what is the need of a space antenna. What is the essentially the main characteristics that this a space antenna must have? Must be a large parabolic dish with the surface as precise as possible, because if the surface is not parabolic, you would not achieve this constructive interference at the focus. The larger the area of the antenna, the larger is the energy collected and the power collected, and therefore the larger will be the voltage at the focus. Okay, so I see a message on the chat, brief explanation of DSN. DSN stays for Deep Space Network. It's a network of antennas that NASA uses to track its planetary exploration missions. So let us go back to this and to the need of parabolic reflectors. So this is crucial, this is important. So first of all, the antenna must be as large as possible in order to collect as more power as possible. Second, the antenna surface must be parabolic as precise, as close as possible to a paraboloid. Because if the antenna were corrugated, okay, then the reflected rays would not be reflected at the focus and will not arrive in phase. Third, the antenna must be pointed as close as possible in order to have the source, the satellite in this case, on the optical axis, that is the axis of the paraboloid. So these are the crucial things. Now, you may wonder, but who are really we sure that the reflected rays reaches the focus of the antenna? For example, if we have a spherical surface, or rather a parabolic surface, would the ray be reflected on a point or in different points? So, who tells us that the reflected rays pass through the focus? Well, yesterday I wrote this short demonstration. I didn't have the patience to write them with PowerPoint equations, so these are handwritten notes, which I hope are legible, are readable, sorry, and you can find here the demonstration. We will not go through it, but just to give an idea, let me take the laser pointer now, just to give you an idea. What we have to demonstrate is that if this is the parabola, okay, which passes by for the origin, the equation of the parabola is the the usual one, y is equal to a x squared, so generic parabola. We have an incoming ray from here. Do you see the laser pointer? Yes. We have an incoming ray from here. Okay. This ray is reflected, and in order to find the direction of reflection, we have to take the tangent to the parabola at the point P, take the normal to the tangent, and specularly reflect this unit vector onto this direction about the normal vector n. So we have first, let me take the pen again, which was better after all. So we have the equation of the parabola here. We write the equation of the tangent. So we take the derivative of the parabola equation. We have here the equation of the normal n. To the parabola at the point P of coordinate x0, y0, and you know that m prime must be equal to minus 1. So the angular coefficient of the normal is 1 minus 1 over 2a x0. So that the unit vector n is a normalization factor, I can write it in this way, 1 as component 1 minus 1 over 2a, where the normalization factor, since this is a unit vector, is this one. You can compute it very easily. So we outline only the procedure of the demonstration. We will not do it. Now, we have the vector n, but we need to find the reflected vector in this direction. So we have to take this unit vector and reflect it about n. And if you remember, when we did the Householder transformations, the elementary reflector is this one. I is the identity matrix. These are the components of the vector n. So we have to apply this transformation, the unit reflector, the elementary reflector, to the versor unit vector y, and y is equal to 0, 1, okay, is a unit vector oriented along y, so opposite to the direction of the incoming waves. And if you do the algebra, which is very simple, you get this equation. So this is the equation of the transformed rays, and here I should have put a hat. Okay? So once we have the transformed, this is essentially the reflected ray, which has component y, 0, 1, plus this normalization factor, plus this quantity here. Okay, so this is the reflected ray. And the reflected ray, in terms of component, has a parametric equation, which is this one. So If this is ty, the equation of a line passing for the point P of coordinate x0, y0 and direction equal to that of the reflected ray ty is this. So this is the parametric equation of that line. R, a generic point of the line, is equal to R0, because this is the point where the reflection occurred, plus the reflected unit vector, ty, times a parameter s, which goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. So we add a vector, along this line. So this is the parametric equation of the reflected ray, which is written explicitly here in this equation. We need to find the intercept with the y-axis. We suspect that the focus is there. And in order to find the intercept, we have to set x equal to 0 in the above equation. And this tells us that the intercept occurs when s has this value. So we set x0 plus the normalization factor times S must be equal to 0, and therefore S has this value. If we replace this value of S into the equation for Y, which is this one, we obtain Y is equal to Y0, and remember that Y0 is equal to A x0 squared. And do all the algebra, substituting this s, this value of s, we find that y is equal to 1 over 4a, which is exactly the location of the focus. And note that this reflection point, this quantity y, is independent of x0 and y0. So is all reflected points, all points of the parabola reflect the ray in that location, in the focus. So this is a demonstration which I will not ask in the exam, and you see the square. The triangle, the upper triangle on the upper right corner, which means that is not necessary. But I think it may be useful to demonstrate mathematically that this is a unique property of a parabola. If you put, for example, a spherical surface, a circle, you would not find the same thing, absolutely. So, with this, we have demonstrated that parabola has maximum directivity. Remember, however, that all our considerations have been made in the geometric optic limits. And the geometric optic limits is a limit that holds only when lambda, the wavelength, goes to zero, so frequency to infinity goes to infinity. And luckily there are physical effects. Why do I say luckily? Well, Because if we go back and let me erase everything, I would like to erase everything. Okay, let me erase everything. Because in the geometric optic limits, the directivity of antenna would be infinite. If you don't point correctly to the satellite, so if the satellite is not on the axis, let me retake the pen, then you would get huge losses in power. Okay? So if the direction of arrival of the rays instead of being this one would be this. So all the game would be completely different because the reflection would occur in a completely different way, and you risk that almost nothing arrives at the prime focus. Luckily, geometrical optics is a limit, and in truth there are physical effects that needs to be taken into account, which make the pointing a much easier thing. Still critical, but much easier. But before we go to the description of the directivity of the antenna, let us consider another configuration that is widely used in space telecommunication, the so-called Cassegrain mount. Okay, Cassegrain mount. So the Cassegrain antenna, in a Cassegrain antenna, the receiving element, the element which detects the voltage, is not placed at the prime focus, but is placed behind the paraboloid. There is an aperture here, you see, and the horn, or the feed as it is called, is placed behind the antenna. Now, in order to do this and preserve phase coherence at the feed here or horn, because this is mandatory to have constructive interference there at the feed, what you need is to place instead, close to the prime focus, an hyperboloidal surface, which is this one. This is the surface is an hyperboloid, so take an hyperbola and rotate about its axis, and you get a hyperboloid. The hyperboloid must have its focus, there are two, the closest one, at the focus of the parabola. So this point F is the focus, the prime focus of the parabola, and also the focus of the hyperboloid. It can be demonstrated, but we will not do it, that the reflected rays with this geometry arrive at the horn with the same phase relationship. So they arrive with in a coherent way, The face is all the same, and the face is all the same, and therefore we have constructive interference. Now, why do we use this apparent complication? Well, the complication is due to the fact that the feed, the horn, which is located down here, looks toward the sky. And since we see there are side lobes, so physical optic effects make essentially the antenna receive signals from multiple directions and not only from the direction of arrival of this ray, so not only from this cylinder, but receives picks up signals also from other directions. Well, by looking at the sky, the feed looks at a colder object than in the case of a prime mount, because with the prime mount, the feed, which is located here, okay, which is located here, can pick up some radiation also from the ground. And the ground is a hot body. So if I put this feed here, some radiation from the ground can be received by the feed. And therefore, this is noise. And we know that noise is larger for hotter objects than black body radiation law. So, looking at the sky, as in the Cassegrain configuration, would provide a lower pickup noise from hot bodies from the ground. And this is why all antennas used for, or let us say, the best antennas used for space telecommunications on ground and also on board for different reasons use a Cassegrain mount rather than a prime focus mount. That is to say, the detector, the feed, the horn, we will see how it's made, is located at the Cassegrain focus and not at the prime focus of the parabola. Okay? Still crucial, phase coherence is preserved. Now, before we define the gain, let us recall some basic concepts of physical optics. Suppose that you have rays coming in a certain direction. Okay. And here you have an obstacle, a wall, or something similar, with a hole of diameter d. The rays behind the aperture will not be seen only in a disk, on this disk D, corresponding to the aperture D, but will give rise to interference fringes. So So the maximum intensity on this screen will be recorded on this axis, D. But you will see power also here. And you will see dark and bright lines fading away as you go at larger distances. This phenomenon is called diffraction. What is the diffraction angle? The diffraction angle I could have exaggerated it. Let us call it delta. Delta is of order lambda over d. So the ratio between lambda and the size of the aperture. Okay? So we have to expect that even for a parabolic reflector, physical optics effects will give rise to a distribution of the power over an angle which is of order wavelength of the radio wave over the diameter of this of the antenna. Okay? So once we have said that, we can go to the definition, a basic definition of the crucial parameter probably of an antenna, which is the gain. We will give two definitions. Well, the gain, first of all, is a definition, is a measurement of the directivity of an antenna, how directive an antenna is. So we read together. The gain of an antenna is the ratio between the radiated power by the antenna in a given direction, okay, in a given direction, to the power radiated per unit solid angle by an isotropic and lossless antenna fed with the same power. So, what does it mean? We have a given power available. We can distribute this power along the cone that we just outlined, this cone here, okay? Or distribute it isotropically. The ratio of the power in a given direction, for example, the optical axis, but we can take also another direction within the beamwidth of the antenna, to the power that we would get in the same direction if the radiation would be isotropically distributed, that is to say, so we have a radiator here and the power is distributed isotropically over space, is a measure of the gain, is the gain of the antenna. So the gain is essentially the area, the solid angle over which most of the radiation is sent over 4 pi, which is the solid angle corresponding to the whole sky. You can look, I took this definition from Wikipedia, which is also captures quite well what the gain is. Is the ratio of the power produced by the antenna from a far field source, so a distant source, on the antenna's beam axis, the axis of the antenna, to the power produced by an hypothetical lossless isotropic antenna, which is equally sensitive to signals in all directions. This is a essentially the same definition, but it points more focuses on the receiver more than on the transmitter. Okay, so the gain is a measure of the directivity, and we will see mathematically tomorrow how the gain is defined. Okay, so these concepts, these definitions will found a mathematical, a rigorous mathematical setup, and we will go quickly through them. Most of you know all this already, and we will quickly go through also the computation of the leak budget and basic concepts which are necessary to understand the following part of the course. Okay? So we stop here for today, and as I promised, since I have to connect also with my space environment students who are waiting for me, sorry for the wrong label of the class. I will correct later, but I'm available for a few minutes to answer questions. So if I don't see any question within, say, 3 minutes, I will quit and I will meet tomorrow at 10 o'clock, 10 a.m. Okay, so since there are no questions, I will stop streaming here, and I'll reopen streaming for the space environment students who may be connected now. So I will separate the two classes. So you will find the two classes on different playlists. Goodbye to everyone, to the Space Missions and Systems students, and we will start the other class. I'll stop streaming now.